week on Wealth Track, two top-performing global investors who are finding the best opportunities on the other sides of the globe. International stock picker Riad Yunus likes the future of companies in Eastern and Central Europe. Bond manager Kathleen Gaffney is looking to Asia for future profits. They are both next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track. And welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. The Age of Enlightenment, where reason and individualism replaced tradition, began overseas in the late 17th century. In the early 21st century, many of the savviest investors are once again looking overseas for financial enlightenment. Now, the jury is still out on how this year will end, but for the last 5 years, foreign markets have outperformed American ones. According to recent guest Dennis Stottman, portfolio manager of the BlackRock Global Allocation Fund, global is the new core. Some comparisons explain why he feels that way. Many economies outside the U.S. are growing more rapidly, as are their rates of savings, investment, and wealth creation. During the first half of the year, markets as diverse as Australia, Brazil, and South Korea reached all-time highs, and many European markets hit multi-year peaks. On this edition of Wealth Track, we'll be talking to two highly successful fund managers. Kathleen Gaffney, a bond fund manager who is increasingly looking abroad for investment opportunities, and Riad Yunus, who runs an international stock fund that's been outperforming its peers for years. Rudolf Riad Yunus is head of international equities at Julius Baer, and he's co-manager of the Julius Baer International Equity Fund, which has returned just under 17% a year over the past 10 years. Yunus grew up in Lebanon and is now based in New York. In a recent interview, I asked him about the investment process that has enabled him to be so successful in good markets and bad.
Investing in the financial jungle is like hunting in the real jungle of the world. Mm-hmm. So as a hunter, you have to know what is your most precious weapon. And for us as human beings, our most precious weapon is our brain. And if you look in the financial market today, most hunters do not use their brain fully. They use only half of their brain.
You know, when I think of right brain, left brain, traditionally, yeah. Left brain is the more analytical and the logical, and the right brain is more creative and intuitive.
It's visionary, yes,
right,
exactly.
Visionary. So when you said that you're using both. So give me an example of today of how you're using both the left and the right brain.
For example, as we said, when you see what's happening in Central and Eastern Europe in this political development and converging with Western Europe. So this is more like a top-down view. This is a visionary thing. You see, okay, this part of Europe was like Western Europe 50 years ago, just because of the after the Second World War, they were separated and put in within the Soviet Empire. So now they're part of the West again. So you know they're going to grow very dramatically and in a very fast manner to catch up with their Western brethren.
So that's a big trend.
Yes,
right.
It's a big trend. That's your right brain. Mm-hmm. The left brain, okay, let me look down, see the companies existing, look at the valuation, look at the sector dynamics, and look at the management, look at the balance sheet, and pick the right company. So you have to use both of your brain.
You know, you talk about buying right, don't overpay. But everyone says that, and everyone says that they're managing risk. But in fact, when you look at results in many other of your competitors, they're clearly not managing risk well at all. So when you talk about risk management, what do you mean?
Okay. I have a couple of analogies, you see. Risk management basically is being about being pragmatic. This is one way to look at risk management, being pragmatic. Another way to look at it as well is risk management is being consistent. To be consistent is basically to be respected by the market. When you have consistent return, it means you have respectable return. It means you're respected by the market. And most people know how to behave in society, but they don't know how to behave in the financial jungle. In society, to be respected, You need to do two things. You need to respect yourself and you need to respect other people. If you respect yourself and you don't respect other people, people are not going to respect you. And otherwise, if you respect other people and you don't respect yourself, people are not going to respect you. So, and same thing in the financial market, you see people do one or the other. Either they respect themselves, I'm a genius, the market is stupid, and then even if it's true, you know, this, there is this wisdom, don't fight with an idiot, because after a while, no one can tell who the idiot is. So if you think NASDAQ is expensive in 98 and you shorted, by 99 you're bankrupt. So you have to be, you know, and so this is the one extreme. The other extreme, there are some people who have no conviction. Mm-hmm. The market is up, they buy, is down, they sell. So basically all what they do is they get whipsawed. And all the money basically is being made by the brokers, and all what they do is index minus 1, minus 2, minus 3% a year. So there's a balance. You have to have a conviction, you need to be dogmatic, but at the same time you have to be pragmatic, you have to be balanced. And this is basically what it is about. It's not that difficult, it needs flexibility, it needs, you know...
So what do you have conviction about right now?
Conviction about, on the very, very big picture, I believe we finished from one bubble from NASDAQ and we created another bubble, which is in real estate.
And this is a global phenomenon?
Yes. Mm-hmm. NASDAQ was also a global phenomenon. If you look at all technology companies, all of them, yes. But the difference is technology equity valuation is nothing compared to global real estate valuation.
And when you're talking about global real estate, it's both residential and commercial?
I would say mostly on the personal balance sheets. I would say mostly residential.
All right. Mm-hmm. Where do you think the most danger lies for serious decline in values?
Yeah. Funny enough, the U.S. real estate is one of the cheapest in the world.
Well, so it's, I understand.
Yes. Because you have such a wide land, you know, and... But in many other markets, like London, I never understand the London pound. I don't understand the London real estate, you know. Thank God I don't bet on this market because I would be bankrupt by now. Even despite my pragmatism, I will not be able to survive it. So, yes, many urban cities, Mumbai, London, even Shanghai, things are really getting out of hand. And like in NASDAQ, it's easy to tell a bubble. The difficult thing is to know when it's going to burst.
Right. So how are you protecting your investors in the Julius Baer International Equity Fund? Is there something that you're doing to manage that?
Yes, of course.
Real estate risk?
If you look at France and Germany, these are two economies that have underperformed the last 10, 15 years because of domestic and structural issues. Mm-hmm. So if you are an investor, this is great because you don't have the excesses that you will see in Spain or Ireland or United Kingdom, or United States, or even some of Asia. So for me, these are very, very nice, safe investments, as well as...
So that's Germany,
yeah,
right?
Germany and France.
And France.
And with France, you have another catalyst with the election of Sarkozy. You may have another, maybe Margaret Thatcher there, if he is able to bring the reform that he can push, you know, and transform the economy and become more and more flexible. We talk about Central Eastern Europe, because this is a region that now is part was Putin in prison and now it's been freed to join the free world. So the development of Eastern Europe is more a political development than a global trade development. So as long as Europe send them money, send them assistance and develop them, then you have a nice investment that's driven by something not called global trade. Mm-hmm. So you're safe. So it's a nice risk reward investment.
There's a theory of investing that essentially it's impossible to time the market.
Yes.
That the only way that you can for a long term investor. And I know that you do think long term, right?
Yes.
I mean, your holdings are 5 years.
That's the idea. When we get into a stock, you have a 5-year view. Usually, correct.
Right. Is that diversification is essentially diversify your risk.
Yes, so we have like about 400, 500 names. So we are one of the most diversified fund you'll ever see. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's much more intelligence in our diversification. We eliminate certain risks that we do not want. We add some exposure that we like. but it's done in a very, you know, a diversified way. We do not, you know, bet the farm on any one thing or
right.
any one stocks or any one theme or any one sector.
So final question, are you always fully invested or do you ever get very defensive and go into cash equivalents or?
Yeah, I mean, one of our philosophy is flexibility is key.
Mm-hmm.
One of the reasons, like many hedge funds, sometimes they do better than long-only fund, not because they are smarter, is because they have a better DNA. They can be long, they can
right.
be short, they can hedge, they can trade. So they can leverage, they can do anything they want. So if you have a lot of freedom, but you have the discipline not to abuse the freedom, then this is, for me, is the optimal place to be.
And is that the case with the Julie Spear
no,
National Equity
of course.
Fund?
But no, because we cannot short, we cannot
right.
leverage. But having ability to have some cash, I think is good as long as the manager know how to use it.
Mm-hmm.
So we can have up to 20% of our portfolio in cash. So it's a tool I'd like to have. So in case we are in a very bad situation,
right.
I could protect my investors by having at least 20% or at most 20% of that portfolio in cash. So basically the value of the portfolio do not go down as much.
And your cash position now?
I would say it fluctuates. It's around 5%.
Oh, so you're not, even though you sound
yeah.
more alarmed about the future right now, you're really not, you're not acting, not being very defensive.
No, I'm being defensive, but it's about what you do. Defensive does not mean go into your cave. Defensive is sometimes your offense is your best defense.
Mm-hmm.
So we're defensive in the sense we don't want to be, you know, we don't want to join the party of this huge global imbalance.
Right.
I don't want to buy too much Chinese stocks. I don't want to buy, you know, too much real estate companies,
mm-hmm.
for example. I want to invest in good fundamentals, economies that I feel, you know, are much more attractive than
right.
than Asia or the U.S. That's why I said Germany, France, for example, some of these oligopolistic industries where you have a pricing power and cheap valuation, or Central and Eastern Europe, to name a few.
And so, the plan is to ride it out
if
comes.
Yes.
All right. Thank you very much, Ria
Thank
Yunus.
You, Consuelo.
Appreciate your being here.
My pleasure.
Our next guest is co-manager of one of the country's most successful bond funds. Kathleen Gaffney has been co-manager of the Luma Sales Bond Fund for nearly a decade, having been hand-picked by its longtime manager, now her partner, bond wizard Dan Fuss. The $12 billion-plus fund has returned more than 9% a year over the last decade, pretty impressive for a bond fund. Gaffney says her team scans the world for opportunities. In a recent interview, I asked her, as individual investors, what should we be paying attention to in the bond markets?
We start every morning by thinking about what's going on in the markets. And you begin at the center in the U.S. with the Treasury market, and you hear what's going on with the economic data, and you think about where the economy is headed. Now, we see some cooling in the economy because of housing, and yet we've seen the market focused on inflation. So in the short term, you've got rates moving up. But the fundamentals are for a cooling and an easing in the cycle. So with higher interest rates in the short term, we've got a buying opportunity in treasuries. So it begins there, but thinking about even longer term, rates are going to be moving up for decades to come.
And so let me stop you there, because that's a sea change. So we've had 20 years of interest rates around the world declining,
right.
going down. But you think that now the next 10 or 20 years that interest rates are going to start going up. And so that's a big change.
That's a big change. And if you're a fixed income investor, it means you've got to think differently. It's been great to have interest rates moving down. For my entire career, interest rates have been going down. And I still have a long career ahead of me. So you've got to think about it differently. Now, inflation can be a negative, but you can also think about how can inflation be a positive. One way for inflation to be a positive is in terms of currencies. So that's caused us to really think very broadly, think outside the U.S., because you've got upside in currency appreciation in many parts of the world, and that's a great opportunity. You've also got supply coming over the next few decades in the emerging markets. And so that will create opportunities from a fundamental standpoint as a fixed income investor. So it's really just expanding that tool set.
And, you know, it's interesting because when you and I both started in the business, which was more than two decades ago, essentially we used to be very U.S.-centric. And so when you thought of high-quality bonds, you thought of U.S. Treasuries and you know, AAA corporate bonds. But now, when I look at the Loomis Sayles Bond Fund, you've gone very global. And when you talk about quality and opportunities, you really are looking overseas. So should global investing and international investing be a part of an individual's bond portfolio as well? And if so, what part?
I think absolutely. And I would say a big part, mm-hmm. that you're really putting all your eggs in one basket by just thinking about bonds as the U.S. And as we've been talking about, rising rates is a negative for fixed income. You want to look for bull markets. Where in the world is inflation coming down? It's coming down in some of the emerging areas.
Such as?
Brazil and Mexico are excellent examples. Mm-hmm. So you've got a very positive fundamental story with inflation coming down, reforms coming through, and high yields right now. And those yields will be coming down. It's a very bullish story, great fundamentals. That's what we look for that you're not finding here in the U.S.
And when you're talking about, are you buying, you know, their government debt, what's called sovereign debt, is that basically what, you know, individual investors should be in bond portfolios that do that?
That do that. Those markets are large and liquid. So it's very easy to get exposure. It's very easy to get in. It's very easy to get out as well. So that liquidity has changed over the years. If you think back 20 years ago, it was a lot tougher to get that exposure. It's much easier to do that now.
Let me ask you about Ben Bernanke or any Fed chief. They call him the second most powerful man in the country. But in fact, you know, other analysts are saying the Fed just doesn't have the kind of clout and control over interest rates that it used to have because there are so many other players now. There are equity funds, there are hedge funds, there are all sorts of people that are lending money and borrowing it that are outside of the kind of the traditional system. How important is the Fed these days?
Oh, the Fed is still very important.
It still is very important.
Yes. But I do think there's got to be more coordination because it's difficult because the capital markets are so global. Mm-hmm. It's the funds coming in from Asia. It's the petrodollars in the Mideast coming into everybody's markets that as a Fed chairman, you don't have as much control of. So there really has to be good coordination and communication, which I think occurs, to make it more successful.
But the fact is that the Fed used to be kind of the controller of interest rates. They really are no longer, right? They have a huge impact, but there's so much else going on in the world that they really don't have the kind of control that they used to have.
That's true. So they really need to use their open mouth policy to kind of direct the market and give it clues on where to go.
Let me ask you about the fact that, you know, China now has more than $1 trillion worth of foreign currency reserves, many of which are invested in U.S. Treasury securities. How much of a problem is that? Is that a positive? Is it a negative? How do you look at that situation?
I like to describe it as we're scratching each other's backs.
Yeah.
And that's been positive. It's just not sustainable. We need to think about that. Interest rates are low, but they are headed higher. And what's a likely contribution to that move higher is the funds heading back home.
And there seems to be a trend, right, where the China has said it's going to diversify and be more into more aggressive investments.
Yes, and we've seen that the foreign holdings are starting to tail off. So mm-hmm. it's beginning, but it's still sizable. So we're not seeing the effect on rates, but it will happen, and we have to think about that as a country from a fiscal standpoint in terms of how are we going to handle higher interest rates.
Now, it used to be that if you looked at other currencies, this was before the euro, for instance, or before some of the emerging markets that you're talking about have become, you know, much more developed markets, that, you know, if you had a lot of money to invest as a government, you didn't have a lot of other choices. The dollar really was the currency of choice. You know, we are the best credit in the world. there are more treasuries, there's liquidity, everything else. But are there some real, does the U.S. Treasury now have some real competition as far as, you know, in other investment alternatives?
I think they're definitely out there, mm-hmm. With higher potential return rates, and currencies that may not be declining. There are going to be currencies that are appreciating, and so that is a very real problem.
Who's our biggest threat as far as, you know, where money would go from China or Japan and or Canada or other big holdings of U.S. Treasuries?
Well, they're looking at where they've got opportunities mm-hmm. to lock up resources. So they're thinking about making those long-term investments. It's happening in Brazil. It's happening in Canada. Mm-hmm. It's happening in Africa. So that money is going into those areas. It's also going to go home in China to support their own social programs. They've got a huge population that they have to think about as well.
Okay. So you know, a couple of last questions. Investing in the bond market for individuals, you know, what's the best strategy for individuals to follow in the bond market, which is really a professional's market. It's not for individual investors to do by themselves.
Right. I think you've got to look at funds as mm-hmm. the way to do that. And I think multi-sector obviously is a great way to achieve high total returns.
And when you talk about multi-sector, that means what? All sorts of foreign markets, industry. I mean, what do you mean by that?
Foreign government and corporate debt, credit here in the U.S., mm-hmm. treasuries, mortgage-backed securities, really having a full tool set where you're able to invest in lots of different fixed income securities. That's the best way to approach the markets.
Okay, and how do you judge the performance of a bond fund? I mean, should you look at what, you know, the 5 or 10 year record is versus its peers versus a benchmark? I mean, you know, how would you, what do you look at?
Well, we look at it in terms of we want to provide the highest total return that we can. So I would look at that 5 to 10 year track record mm-hmm. and compare it to other similar managers. So if you're looking at multi-sector, look at other multi-sector managers. The typical benchmark that people will talk about is the Lehman Government Credit Index.
Right.
And that's a good benchmark for the broad market. But if you're going to be investing in many sectors, some that have higher risk, it's really a better benchmark to compare it against your peers. So it's apples to apples in terms of the additional risk that you're taking.
All right. Final question. The bond market's been in a bull market for the last 20-some-odd years. What do the next 10 or 20 years look like?
Oh, I think we've got a couple of cycles ahead of us. We're coming in on the close of this one. I think interest rates start to back up, and it really is a function of our corporations going to start spending. That will be the additional pressure. We know there's a looming deficit problem, and that's going to...
In the U.S.
In the U.S.,
right?
Right. And that if corporations start to compete with the government, that will pressure interest rates up. But I don't see that being a real issue in the next cycle. It might be the next one after that, when you've got a lot of competition of those emerging countries today who have fully emerged, and there will be real competition for not only natural resources, but also financial resources.
All right, so that's what, in another 5 years, that's when we really have to worry? Or how long do you think it's going to take?
I think that might be looking out 10 years or so.
All right. Kathleen Gaffney from the Loomis Sayles Bond Fund, thank you so much for being here on WealthTrack.
Thank you, Consuelo. It's been great to be here.
No matter how long it takes, the overseas train has already left the station, and it is time to hop on board. Which leads me to this week's action point. Consider increasing your exposure to non-U.S. stocks. By most accounts, American investors are underinvested overseas. One recent estimate is that the total of U.S. institutional and individual holdings in foreign stocks is only about 17%. And for many individuals, the figure is probably lower. Noted investment authorities like Wharton professor Jeremy Siegel have told WealthTrack in the past that Americans would be wise to invest a substantial chunk of their portfolios abroad. Siegel recommends as much as 40% of financial assets in non-U.S. stocks and bonds. Now, this may sound aggressive, but you get a different perspective when you realize how fast many of the world's economies are growing and how much wealth is being created in their markets.
As we reported recently, the value of Europe's 24 stock markets, including Russia and the emerging European economies, has exceeded the capitalization of the U.S. stock market for the first time since World War I. As foreign markets have appreciated faster than American ones, the U.S. market, as a percentage of the world's overall market value, has shrunk. So it makes sense, as a long-term strategy, to go where the growth is. Among the funds recommended by independent research firm Morningstar are a low-cost index fund, Vanguard's Total International Stock Index Fund, which provides exposure to the whole world of foreign equities, including emerging markets. And one of their favorite actively managed funds is Dodge & Cox's International Stock Fund. Our guest Riyadh Yunus's Julius Baer International Equity II Fund is also a top Morningstar choice. So within your comfort zone, think internationally so your portfolio truly spans the globe. Well, it is time for us to conclude this edition of WealthTrack. Thanks for visiting with us. If you missed any part of this program or want to see it again, just go to our website, WealthTrack.com. It will be available for web and podcast viewing starting on Monday. In the meantime, have a happy Labor Day weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.